those in the back.
Thank you for that.
You're
time
welcome.
That worked
you're
out
welcome.
Great.
I'm so glad. Yeah. Coming all the way in.
Our mission offering
news for you. Remember the manna bags we've been doing? I want to say thank you. We've done great. You probably, all of you, have given out close to 100 this year. And I just wanted to give a thank you to you. We always put in the bags where to go so you can find free food, so they know that as well. I just hand mine out the window and I always say, I don't have any money, but I have a bag. Would you be interested? And I always want to say, God bless you. But guess what? Almost without fail, they turn and say to me, God bless you. So I want to say God bless you to you also for being so helpful. The ones that brought in supplies, the ones who made donations, the ones who helped pack it, and all of you that gave something as well. Thank you so much. It's a great start in our mission group. We have a wonderful mission group that we go all over the world, but we also go on the curb at home as well. So, I was hungry, and you fed me.
Thank you, Anne, and our mission group for putting this together, and we appreciate all of your help. Let us prepare our hearts and minds for worship.
Oh. laying to rest the former things, making all things new. Trusting in God's grace, let us confess our sin.
Risen Christ, you are Lord of lords, you are King of kings, and no one works like you. We proclaim your kingdom with our lips and voices, but not so much to our living. Too often the things you want rule our lives rather than you. Too often our own needs get all our attention and not the needs of others. This is not how life in your kingdom should look. Christ our King, you did not come to condemn, but to love. Love us in the power of your forgiveness, and make our lives witness who you are and who you call us to be.
Hear our confession as we pray silently. Amen.
Amen.
The cleansing and the cleaning waters of baptism. God's grace for you and for me. The Lord is gracious and merciful, quick to forgive.
In the name of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God.
Because we need to join you to join us.
tell you about me. Pilate replied, I'm not a Jew, am I? Your own nation and the chief priests have handed you over to me. What have you done? Jesus answered, my kingdom is not from this world. If my kingdom were from this world, my followers would be fighting to keep me from being handed over to the Jews, but as it is, my kingdom is not from here. Pilate asked him, so, you are a king? Jesus answered, you say that I am a king. For this I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice. Pilate asked him, what is truth? After he said this, he went out to the Jews again and told them, I find no case against him. The grass withers and the flower fades, but the word of our Lord is stands forever. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
While this week we look at the final moments of Jesus' life.
and with Pilate, the Roman authority figure. In this text, unlike what we find in other years when Matthew or Luke is the lectionary text, we get a fuller picture of Pilate and some of the angst that he feels in the position in which he is placed. He's a governor of a Roman territory, and it is his responsibility above all else to keep the peace. And the Pax Romana, the peace of Rome, is all about keeping people in their place, not disturbing the status quo. Insurrections, riots were not to be tolerated and would be met with swift punishment. The religious leaders knew that well, knew Pilate's responsibility, knew the trigger points to encourage his involvement in their concerns, and they used what they knew of Pilate to their full advantage. You see, the Jewish religious leaders had a problem with Jesus. He did not follow the rules. He insists the larger picture is more important. He says such things as, "Humankind was not made for the Sabbath, but the Sabbath was made for humankind. Therefore, some rules would be broken on the Sabbath, like healing people or feeding people, because God actually cares more about people than rules." Not only did Jesus expand the Jewish understanding of the law, he also did scandalous things like eat with tax collectors and prostitutes. He also said they were the ones getting into heaven before the self-righteous religious people. Jesus had all kinds of people following him. He really did have friends in low places. And he even suggested, sometimes outright said, that he and God the Father have a special relationship. Jesus liked to stir up some good trouble, as the late John Lewis talks about. Jesus' life-giving ministry sure upset the wrong people in his day, the people with power, so something had to be done to shut them up. And it all began here, by bringing him to the Roman power authority and suggesting that this rabble-rouser is likely to cause unrest. But the clincher argument for the religious leaders is to tell Pilate, "By the way, he says he's a king." They knew that would raise the eyebrows of the Roman official, because there is only one king after all. The emperor of Rome. They were good, these religious leaders. They knew what buttons to push with Pilate, but Pilate was not convinced. In the end, Pilate capitulates to their desire because of his captivity to his own wealth and power. If he acquiesces to the powerful religious leaders, will he risk killing an innocent man? If he treats this man according to his conscience and lets him go, he risks losing his position, because these powerful religious leaders will aim without a cause of sin. Rome was not like scenes, and unrest in Rome would take a dim view on a governor who could not control his people. So Pilate, we think, at least in this passage, is between a rock in a hard place. Pilate does seem curious about this man who doesn't seem threatened by him or his power, but like most people with power, Pilate is entrapped by the love of his position and by what others think of him. He will not be the only one Joseph Small, in his work on the great ends of the church, says the paramount truth in our world is not a fact, it's not a doctrine, it's not a private belief. The truth is a person, Jesus Christ, who is God with us and for us, way back when and now. The truth is the way, and the way is life. It is not just an intellectual exercise. It's not a particular belief. It's a life lived in faithfulness to the person. And I would add to what Joseph Small says, that it's a life filled with joy. So this king, the only one we are to bow to, is truth. So when we live as Jesus did, we live truth also. And you may ask, so how did our king live? Open and welcoming. Jesus associated with unlikely people, the ones who make us uncomfortable. He associated with the sick, the poor, the ailing, the children, even the fishermen. And instead of acquiescing to the powerful, he confronted them. He did not bow to the religious right of his day, the powerful, the government, even the institution of the church. He bowed only to God, and in doing so, he brought life, meaning, and purpose to men. He gave his all to God. He did this at great risk to his own life. The risk that we take to do the right thing, well, the risk that we take to pale by comparison. If we are to be loyal subjects to our king, we must be welcome to the stranger and alien in our midst. We must help to heal the sick and the lonely. We must work to help the poor. We must speak truth to power. It is not some ideal to dismiss, but a life to live. In living Jesus' kind of truth, we recognize Jesus as King, and we cannot help but be joyful. The world around us may say truth is relative, or that Jesus would never really want us to sacrifice our position and power. But we know differently. To follow Christ the King and live his truth means it will cost something. What a king he was and is. A king like no other. Not dressed in royal robes, no jeweled crown, no temple palace all his own, no territories to invade and capture, no armies to a king who chose to invade our hearts and minds. A king who chose to show us a different kind of community. A king who demands something from us. Now that's a king worth celebrating and following. It is our history at Rockledge Presbyterian Church. And with God's help, it is our future, too. Won't you be a part of it? Amen.
Will you please stand? Let us confess the faith of our baptism. I believe
in God, the Father Almighty. Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by
seated.
Joined the church, and I went back to my promise to God that I would do something. is a pot, a clay pot. God made the pot. And the pot's empty. If I let the pot of the rain, if I let God into my pot, and He pours His holy water into me, then I become a blessing. I can provide thirsty people with water. I can water with the plow. So all of a sudden, the vessel begins to work. Now, when I'm pouring out that holy water in my vessel, obviously I'm going to run out. But God's generosity always continues to fill that vessel, so that it will continue. So you're all pots, okay? You all have brains. And you can fill your pot with holy water and become a vessel as you're choosing. And I would just hope that we all become perfect vessels. May God bless us all. Thank you.
Thank you, Julian. And please don't mind me when I start calling you a pot.
Thank you.
tiring. And so we are delighted that she still loves us and wants to be with us. So you come to us as a member of one holy Catholic church. As little C, that means universal church, into which you were baptized and by which you have been nurtured. We are one with each other, sisters and brothers in the family of God, and we rejoice in the gifts you bring to us. There is one body and one spirit, just as you were called to the one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in all. And so I have a few questions. Who is your Lord and Savior? Will you be Christ's faithful disciples to the best of your ability, obeying his word and showing his love? Okay? I have questions for you because no one of us do this journey of faith by ourselves. We need each other. Will you, the members of this congregation, welcome Janie, Ed, Penny, Susan, and Sherry as our new friends in the faith, just as Christ has welcomed us to the glory of God? Will you?
Yeah.
Let us pray. Holy God, we praise you for calling us to be a servant people and for gathering us into the body of Christ. We thank you for choosing to enrich our fellowship with the gifts of our new friends in the faith. Together, may we live in your spirit and so love one another that we may have the mind Christ our Lord, to whom we give honor and glory forever. Amen. And you are able to greet our newest members at the close of the worship service in the narthex, because they will leave with me at the close of the service so that we can greet you. Then we will greet Ed and Janie at another time. God's grace, thank you. Let us pray. Most holy and grace-giving God, we are grateful you sent your Son to show us what you are like and what you want from us. Forgive us when we forget that Jesus' kingship is defined by sacrificial love. Help us recognize true power and authority can only be accomplished in living a life worthy of his calling, in speaking the truth. Teach us his kind of love, we pray, and give us courage when we falter and wish to go in a different way. We are grateful for the history of this place, for the way you inspired our founder, Cornelia McGreer, in 1877, when she moved here from Georgia, to persevere in helping establish Christian education and a church in this place. We are grateful for our history. May we do her proud with how we proceed into the future. More importantly, may we keenly listen to your Spirit and follow your Spirit's guidance, both now and in 2022, and even beyond that. We are grateful to the staff, the buildings, the leaders, and the ministry of this place, and we ask that you help us do the right thing to honor those who have gone before us as we move forward into the future. Guide each one of us to prioritize our lives and keep you as the center. Help us to prayerfully discern what you are asking us to do to support your church, both financially and in our service. Today we pray for Debbie Cowell and the family as they grieve and we grieve the loss of Dottie Mailey. In this Thanksgiving season, may we take comfort in one another and remember those who are noticing an empty chair at their table this year.
We pray for all those who are awaiting surgery, who have completed surgery, or who are ill. May your healing and comforting presence be with each one. Today we pray for Tom and for Rick, for Flina, for Dick, for Eric, for Daria, and the many others who are on our hearts and minds together. Now hear us as we pray the prayer we have been taught, saying, Our Father,